when you think about Mongo and you think about the Hall of Fame, does he deserve to be in your
I think
opinion?
He does. And, you know, this is, it's going to be a challenge because we already have two guys on the defensive line who are in the Hall of Fame. But I think if you look at Steve's statistics, you know, he certainly has a chance. And we're all hopeful that he'll be able to, you know, be the third player and the fourth defensive player in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, you think about just his stats and where he sits. He's second all-time leading sack leader behind Richard Dent, who has a gold jacket. Why is it, and I've always thought about this, why doesn't he get enough respect when it comes to what he did for the game? Is it because sometimes you get lost in there in the middle and the guys on the outside are getting most of the credit?
I think, you know, one, Dan Hampton and Richard Dent deserve being in that Hall of Fame.
Yes.
But I think, you know, defensive end, of course, they're getting the sacks. And, you know, Dan, in my mind, you know, when he was drafted in 1979, changed our defense and changed our team. I mean, he was that type of leader and had that type of impact. And I think that Steve coming in as a free agent had been cut from the New England Patriots. That probably had some impact on it. But, you know, I think that, you know, we had Singletary. We had so many different people on the defense that really deserved to be in the Hall of Fame and were making huge plays. And I think he did get a little lost in that shuffle. You know, I got cut from the Miami Dolphins. He got cut from the Patriots. That sticks with you. You know, there's a little insecurity about that. You've got something to prove. For me, think about it. I was right across from the defensive line, you know, and I could, you know, critical times, I'm looking at Steve, I'm looking at Richard, I'm looking at Dan. We need you to make a play, you know, and they did so often. And if you don't have a good defensive line to put a pass rush on, you're not going to have a good secondary either. And so I think that, you know, Steve was happy being, you know, the third amigo, if you will. But I think, you know, hopefully we'll get some real good news here in short order.
Yeah, it seems like the way that he was off the field, pretty much the same way that he was on the field, wasn't it?
I'll tell you, he off the field, he was kind of a wild man. You know, after games, you know, there were several times when after getting done with doing my radio or TV stuff, I joined those guys. And I remember one time we had our drinks and I said, you know, if I was as big as you guys, I could probably beat you up. And with that, Danny Hampton pulled me up over his head and said, but you're not. And then threw me into the ground. And Mongo helped me up. He goes, hey, Hamp, you're going to hurt the little guy. And you kind of know your place, right? Yeah, Steve, I mean, those are just really fun times, obviously. But, you know, it's been a rough road having to go out and see him deteriorate with ALS. And, you know, he's handled it with class. And I just, you know, it's sad.
What was your first reaction when you heard that he was diagnosed with ALS?
You know, you wonder, you know, is that related to football or is that just bad luck? I'd never known anyone with ALS. And I had a teammate from Yale who passed away a few years ago and decided to do an assisted suicide and just didn't want to live that life. And Steve, every time you go out there, even though he can't communicate, he is engaged. And, you know, it's tough on everybody and it's very tough on his wife and his daughter.
But it's saying something about seeing the pictures of all you guys going out and seeing him. I know for him not being able to speak right now, to be able to communicate by blinking his eyes, you know it has to warm his heart to know that you guys are there by his side.
Oh, yeah. You know, he's got a lot of support. And, you know, whether it's, you know, his teammates, the McCaskies have been very, very generous in a very quiet way. And I think, you know, anybody who knew or played with him, not just the Bears, but, you know, he went up to the Packers for a couple of years. Matter of fact, I think it was a Sunday night or maybe a Monday night game, pouring rain when they retired Butkus and Sayers jersey. And I was taking a woman out for a charitable thing. She had won me to take her out on that field. It was pouring rain. We're there and I'm in the north end zone. All of a sudden I get lifted off my feet and it's Steve. He's come up behind me. He's with the Packers and he's gonna dump me into the ground. I'm yeah, Steve, don't do that. And you know, he didn't, but you know, there were a lot of fun times with Steve McMichael.
Yeah, I think about his time of being in the league, to playing so long, playing for the Bears and the Packers.
And then, you know, pro wrestling.
I thought about that. For all the personalities that were on that 85 squad, he might have had one of the biggest ones. When you think about life after football for him, didn't that just fits as it being a pro
Absolutely.
Wrestler for
Very
him,
natural,
right?
Right? Yeah. Very natural for Steve. And I remember watching at United Center, and I got to go into the locker room, meet all these famous wrestlers. It was a hoot. But like you said, it was a very natural path for Steve.